Hi everybody, Joker from 92 Squadron here, and this is a picture of the target area that we are attempting to bomb on this sortie. So let's hop into the cockpit and get ourselves going.
Hello everybody, 92 Squadron Joker here, and we are in a Blenheim, trying to select the inner fuel. What is that? That's the inner. That's off. That's the inner. Set our selector here to the inner tank. I have about 65 gallons of fuel in each, give or take a little bit. And we are about to do our start off, so we're going to select engine 1. Advance our throttle about quite a bit of the way actually, and hit the startle motor. And then we'll start running forward a little bit here because we didn't set our chocks, but I don't mind that. And there we go, our radiators are open. And we are just going to roll her down here. Now, it looks like we have parked the aircraft at the wrong end of the airfield. So as we navigate our way down here towards the other buildings, we'll have a little bit of a quick chat on what we're going to do here. If we go to the mission briefing in the map, we'll see that option number 7 or target number 7 is the port of Dieppe, the fuel storage there. So what we're going to do is back up on the old speed there, and we are going to set our tools, our protractor, and we are going to try and draw a line. Wait a minute. What we're going to do is we're going to control our aircraft first, because we are tearing across the apron here somewhat precariously. Now, I have reduced my fuel just to make takeoff a little easier, and I know that I've got enough range with 60 odd gallons to make the round trip and probably orbit the target a little bit. We're going to be going in from about 10,000, and back on the stick and just applying a little bit of brake, and it seems that the brake is the hydraulic lines are stronger on the left than they are on the right, or they fill on the left first before they fill on the right. Okay, we'll come around here now and we'll line up for a takeoff. I see some aircraft up there heading kind of in a southerly direction. I hope they're friendly. I don't see any flak. Alrighty. We'll bring her to a stop here if she will stop for us. And she's not stopping. There we go. There we go. That's a bit better. Temperatures are a little mixed because, anyway, never mind. Sometimes I forget to select all with my engine controls. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to draw a line between Wilmington and Dieppe, which is basically going to go through the middle of the aircraft on both of them. And there's a little circle here that's in the middle of the line. Depends on where you start drawing the line that it appears. I'm going to put the mouse, after I complete the first line, I'm going to put the mouse in the middle of that circle, hold down the left button and pull down and try and get a line that is parallel to the vertical lines, and that tells me 149. The second line that I've drawn is 180 degrees. At the cross end, and obviously 0 degrees up here. If I was to select this line here, which is 31 degrees, I would have to take that away from 180. If I go down towards 180, it gives me 149 degrees, and that is the heading that we're going to use. So on the course setter, I'm going to set that to 149, which is about there. 148, 149. That's all I'm going to do with that. We will use the directional gyro in a moment, but essentially, when that's at 149 degrees, we're going to set that manually to zero and engage our autopilot when appropriate, which will follow 0 degrees. So it's not quite the correct way to use that, but never mind. We're going to advance our full fine pitch. We're going to drop our boost cutout, take off our chocks, put in full flaps, and advance the throttle progressively till we have full throttle and we are rolling for our takeoff. We do have a little bit of a hill to our left, so our takeoff track is going to be airborne, and then we're going to veer a little bit to the right just so that we climb up over that without any drama. Engine speed, our airspeed is good. We are over 110 knots about now. Gently back on the stick, just ever so gently, and not so gently as it turned out. We are airborne. Undercarriage is up. We're going to bring our flaps up as well because we do have enough airspeed to be able to climb out of this. And I'm just applying a little bit of trim to get ourselves into a climb, which is nice. Now we're not so far off the ground here, but we are climbing with speed. This is the waterway that I use as my guide coming in, and we do have a bit of trimming that we need to do here now. Actually, quite a bit of trimming that we need to do. I'm going to bring back my propeller to course, and I'm going to set my boost cutout to the off position, and we're going to try and let things settle down a little bit here. Going to turn the aircraft now around towards 149 degrees, and on the compass down here on the bottom left, that means I'm going to turn until the lines on the compass, how do I put this, until the north-south marker lines up with the lumber or jumper or whatever those lines are called. I can't remember the name now. I think they're called the lumber lines, are they? Something like that. Going to have to trim ourselves for a little bit of a climb here. Not that much of a climb, Jack. Uber lines, Luber lines, Luber lines, that's what they're called. Those lines down there. At the moment, we've overdone it. We need to turn ourselves a little bit back towards the east until we get those two parallel lines and the north-south pointer on the compass all in line. Oh, actually, we're going the wrong way, sorry. We are going the wrong way. Airspeed is good, engine temps are good, and we are getting ourselves lined up fairly well there. That's a little bit too much now. Bring it back ever so slightly. And I am manually zeroing out the directional gyro now. That's fairly close to damn good. So I'm going to put on the course autopilot and apply a little bit of trim to get ourselves climbing, and we'll put a little bit of correction in on our rudder as well. And that's not three bad at all. We will maintain this course now. I might have to do a little bit of course correcting just to get that pointer more parallel with the lumber lines, but my hand's off the stick pretty much now and off the rudder, and we are going quite well. I am going to now correct, because you can see the north-south pointer is not quite parallel with the lines, so we'll do a little bit of correction here, nice and slowly, to get them to come back in, given that we're not so far away yet. Now that's not too bad. If we look at those lines there, they are not too bad at all, if I do say so myself. Actually, they're not great either. That's a lot better. That's a lot better. Okay, temperatures, like I said, are good. The actual engine temperatures themselves are up on the 150, 160 mark. This is the engine oil temperature of 52. Everything else is looking pretty good. We have a 700 feet per minute climb, pulling 170 knots, and we are heading for Angel's 10. More like 1500 feet per minute now. It bounces around for me a little bit too much, but it is what it is, and we are learning here. If we pop into the Bombardier's setup here, because I know I'm aiming for 10,000, I'm going to increase the sight up until about 10,000. We're at 10,200 there. And we know that we're going to be traveling at about 220 miles an hour, so I'm going to add in 220. We'll worry about our slip angle a little bit later, but right now we are passing through 5,000 feet and 160 knots. So all is good. Our slip angle is pretty much zero, and we're tracking quite nicely on our course for a change. That's good. What we'll do is we will course correct once we get into our altitude and once we have long range visual on the target. And then it's down to pressing the buttons at the right time, basically. Oh, one other thing that I'm going to set in the Bombardier's controls are the distribution mode, and I'm going to set it to salvo. This first button here will set it to single, and the last button sends it to salvo. I'm going to use salvo mode. I'm going to drop all four bombs at the same time. The aim here is to try and get a fairly tight spread of ordnance on the main area of the field, of the fuel dump, and hopefully set it all going up in smoke and flames and stuff at once. Radiators are full open. I fly with them full open quite often. I do close them sometimes for speed and when I want to try and get efficient, but I'm really looking at the engine oil temperatures and managing them that way. The engine temperatures will get up into the 170-180 mark. 175, I think, is what the second one is, and that's fairly standard. So that's all good. Fuel-wise, we're going to be fine, because I've flown this a couple of times before. And that's what's going on, basically. You don't want to leave your boost cutout on for very long. You can get away with it for a while, but don't forget to turn it off. Otherwise, bad things happen. You end up overstressing the engine, and it becomes a little bit more difficult to fly this aircraft and see anything. Everything starts to vibrate and shake. But we're holding a nice steady climb of about 1,200, 1,300 feet per minute. So things are looking so far so good. I'm on my own here. Typically, 92 Squadron will fly a wing or a couple of elements together, and that's a much more effective way of taking on the target because you can basically watch out for each other, and obviously you're carrying that much more potential damage. So if one of you misses or if there's a problem, the sortie is abandoned in that individual case, but you do have some friendlies with you, to get the job done, basically. The other thing that we're trying to encourage is to encourage escorts, and that is, as the campaign season will kick in, that's going to become more and more important because it's the escorts that are going to keep the attacking fighters away from the bombers and afford the bombers the ability to achieve their objective, and in doing so, potentially gain a victory during the mission or during the map. We've now reached 10,000. I'm not going to level off here onto the Mode 22 autopilot just yet, and the reason for that is that Mode 22 is set for about 220 miles per hour. We're at 160, so a good 60 miles per hour away, and the aircraft will dip its nose, build up its speed, and lose some altitude. So I'm going to climb up to 11 or a little over 11 before I knock in the Mode 22, and we're reaching 11,000 now. So let's go to 11.2, and then I'll hit the Mode 22 autopilot and watch the nose dip. And you can watch our altitude drop off a little bit as well here as the aircraft builds up speed. We're passing 190 for 220 miles per hour. We're dropping back down through 11,000 as we do that, and we are maintaining our course. Everything else is looking good. Sun is pretty bright up here, and we are going to touch off the clouds here as well. Now, what we'll end up doing here is the altitude will slowly stop reducing, and we might undulate a little bit as the aircraft stabilizes onto its target speed of 220 miles an hour. We are a little bit away from our target as well, so we have a little bit of time to prepare and think about what we're doing here. So if I pop onto the map here very quickly, oh, let's turn off those tools, we don't need them. We are in the middle of the channel here now, heading south, but probably about midway, I would assume. And we are heading for the port of Dieppe. Now, we need to be able to recognize Dieppe, essentially. And there's a few telltale landmarks that we'll use. Dieppe is a city that is on the coast, and it does have a three tributary river behind it. I don't know the name of the river, but the river does have some significant water, lakes and things to the southwest, or southeast, excuse me, of Dieppe. Le Tréport is up here on the northern side, and there is a small river south of Le Tréport that sometimes can be used as well. The reason I'm saying that is my approach is not going to be guaranteed directly for Dieppe. I may be a little bit north or a little bit south, but I'm going to be in the general area here. Once we get very close, let me move that. So in Alpha Victor 9, the square of Alpha Victor 9, the line between Alpha Victor 9 and Alpha Victor 10, right on the coastline, there's a number of forestries and little quills there. That's a signature that I can use. I can actually use them as a lineup if I need to. I'm hoping that because the cloud is a little bit dispersed, I'm going to be able to get in on the target visually. and visually from the air directly, coming in from the sea, that is, and not need to line up with a landmark on the ground. We'll have to wait and see exactly how that plans out. We're losing it now because we're just about to go into cloud, but once we get to the other side of the cloud, we're already able to see a few waterways that are, splitting the land on the coastline there. And so the challenge here is to identify it correctly. And this is what I'm thinking. I'm thinking we're dead on for Dieppe, based on the fact that, let me zoom in here a little bit, we do seem to have a tributary and a water system there, and we do have another tributary below it, which would be there. So we're looking fairly good, but we are a little south. Yes, we are. So what we're going to do is we're going to course correct now. And we're just turning on the nose here. Get the pipper lined up on there. And we've overcorrected slightly. But as we look, we do have some forestry here on the coastline. And then we do have these rivers opening up here behind. There's the first tributary, there's the second, and there's the third.
Hello,
Sods, how you doing?
Iceman. Yeah, fine, do that.
So we line up here.
You know, we fucked, didn't we? Because we're shit. Down, kick your car.
I'm on a bombing run over to Dieppe at the moment, Sods.
Oh, that's what you're opening in the close lobby.
Okay, so that's one of the guys coming in onto the channel here. We're going to pop down to the Bombardier now. And we're going to use this edge here of the black panel.
Bravo, adesso.
And we're going to line up here directly with this estuary. And we're going to try and work our way in to the target from there. So that's the tree sides there, and we have the tributary. And then we have Dieppe just there. I don't know what he's saying on the radio, but it's kind of funny. The Ambo de Wopas. Not sure what that is. We're going to set our altitude. We are at 10,800 feet, and we set ourselves for a little over 10,003. So we're going to move up to 10,800 feet on our setting there. You can see it in the blue. Our speed is about 220, which is what we had set.
Where is Iceman? Is he around? Is he in a race, probably?
And we're rocking and rolling here to zero slip angle, so that's pretty good. We do have a little bit of cloud, but we've already lined ourselves up when we had the opportunity to, so
one.
I'm hoping that we're going to be pretty good for this run in here. In preparation, I'm going to drop in onto the gun side, talk about this a little bit. There's this site, this metal or grey circle with the gap in the top of it.
But it's the qualifying, isn't it?
This is our
turn off.
This is our site for there. Bear with me for 1 second.
Park firm A, make sure it's off if you can. So that
channel switched.
Just get into a different channel here for that. We're going to see if we can get the target to track down between this red and this white and black line with the two red dots on it. And we're using the one that's on the right-hand side. That's our target. And that's what we're going to try and get ourselves in on. And once the target appears, basically on this pipper here, we're going to drop. We're already set to salvo mode. And it's just a case now of flying her in. if I come off the gun a little bit and zoom in quite a bit, we can see that there is, right on our line, there is our target. So I'm just going to straighten this up here a little bit, and I am fairly happy with that. So now it's back in our gun, back in on our gun sight, and we are waiting to drop the ordnance, basically. And I think we're looking pretty good. We might be slightly south, actually. Going to make one more course correction, and we're going to call it there. Now it's a case of just flying it in, and we're just watching the gun sight, and the top of the screen, our land is going to appear. One more check. 220 and 10,800 feet, no slip. And there we go. Our land is coming in, and we are going to make another course correction here. I am pretty happy with that. And once it's in, we are dropping now. Bombs away. I'm going to keep pressing it a couple of times just to make sure. From this point, we can get back into our pilot's position. We can knock off our autopilot. And we can go and see by turning if our bombs have done any damage. If they have, we will see smoke. I'm bringing her around a bit aggressively here to try and get her around in time. We have an 11 second delay on our bombs, by the way, which I kind of use all the time. Now, that big nacelle is in the way, but we will now see if our bombs have hit. There's the fuel tanks, and so far nothing. If we drop down to the bombardier position, we might be able to continue to monitor. Not very good at flying in that position. I'm not sure they went. I'm a little concerned, because I kind of would have expected something by now. He says we might make another run, and I will use a different control. To drop the bombs. Well, we're staying looking here anyway. Might have just been a little impatient. Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to fly inland here. We don't have any enemy at the moment. We're going to make a turn and come back, and see if we can do that again. I wonder if that actually worked. Either that or I missed, which is entirely possible, of course. Doesn't look very much like I succeeded. Chop my throttle a little bit here, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to drop altitude, make a steady slow turn to the right, passing through 10,000 now, and I'm going to fly out and press my button once more. I guess I missed. which is a bit annoying. Passing down through 9,000, so our speed is fairly high. Could chop the throttle quite a bit. Throw in a little bit of rudder just to mix it up. We do have to be careful here because we will have flak. But I definitely didn't hit them. So what we're going to do now is we're going to fly in very low. Through 4,000, 3,000, 2,000, and this is a bit suicidal now because we are going fast, but we are going very low. We're going to come out very low, but I'm going to basically drop these literally on top of it at 500 feet now. And then we're just going to go full power and carry out. You can see some tracer rounds going over our canopy as we try and fly out without sinking too much into the water. And we're going to climb out in a gentle arc here now and see if we can get a view back. Visibility is kind of limited in here, but no, they're very intact. This is not successful. What we're going to do instead now is we are going to fly out a reciprocal course to the 149 that we were on. Basically we're going to make the header go a little bit to the north. We're just going to turn the north south pointer around, line it back up with the lumber lines, and we're going to head her back to Wilmington. So for some reason compass doesn't want to turn, or I'm looking at the wrong point on the compass to turn. Always looking at the wrong point on the compass. Come on, compass. Come around. Nice and steady there now. Yeah, that's better. So we'll decrease that fairly aggressively here in preparation. Probably about 30 degrees more. We'll bring it in. Break out of there. Yeah, that'll do. Over coconut. That's very good. If I could just frickin' change that now. And course is on. Now we just need to stabilize our trim and we'll be on our way back to Wilmington, hopefully to make a nice landing and ponder what the hell we were doing flying out here and not being able to hit our target. I do have a bit of practice obviously that I need to do, but save for the little detail of actually hitting the target with your bombs, which we may follow up on in a future video. This is a trouble-free so far. Let's not count our chickens. But so far it's been a trouble-free sortie. And that's good. Altitude now is about 3,000. Give or take, and we will fly back fairly low here. Don't really want to climb out. I want to stay below the clouds and use all the opportunities that I can to stay away from the eagled-eyed enemy fighters who may not appreciate the fact that I even attempted to destroy their fuel depot. I thought I should have hit them there. I'm a little disappointed that I didn't. But anyway, these things happen. And we're kind of right here. We may have possibly been hit a little bit. I didn't hear any hits, but it is entirely possible that we picked up a shot or two. I am having a little bit of right slip in here. Quite a bit, actually. See if I can correct that. Not easily done. Flying through the clouds, this is where the old instrument kind of flying comes, where you're watching your main six here for rate of climb, level wings, that kind of thing. In clouds, gentle climbing, given your altitude, is preferred because, but as long as you're looking at your altitude and your altitude is set correctly, of course, then everything should be okay. And it's just a case of keeping your horizon fairly decent and your rate of climb, excuse me, nice and nice and consistent and level. We're dipping a little bit here now, so I'll just put in a spot of trim, and we should be okay. Temperatures are still okay. Fuel has reduced quite a bit, look, but we are comfortable. The art of bombing. I do need to do a bit of work on my targeting. That's fairly obvious. But the navigation side is coming along quite nicely. Now, this was a Direct 2 navigation, which is fine, but things are fairly quiet at the moment on the server for this video. I'm taking the opportunity to use the time to do this. When things are a little bit more busy, it will not be such a good idea always to do a Direct 2. It might be much more sensible to fly in a non-Direct 2 direction to begin with, to a predetermined point out somewhere in the water over there behind the left nacelle, and then make a course turn to target, having plotted that on the map in advance. And then you would use the clock, which you can't really see on this instrument panel so easily, but there is a clock digitally on the screen in red down in the bottom left corner. And that's a real clock using real time, so you can use your own clock on your arm, if on your wrist or whatever, if you so wished as well. Not sure where the actual clock is. I think it's in here behind everything. They really could do it one somewhere else, but anyway, what you would do then is you would set a speed, and with your map calculations, basically up on here, if we were flying from Wilmington to Dieppe, and let me just move this a little bit away because I want to keep an eye on the six. If we put on our tools again and just use our ruler, we would maybe draw a line down here and fly due south for 59 miles, and then turn and fly into Dieppe due east, which would be somewhere around about 37 miles. Now, flying down here to the 60-mile mark due south, that's 60 miles, essentially, and if we are flying at, to make the math simple, if we're flying at 180 miles an hour, then it'll take us a little bit with 20 minutes to get there, including takeoff and so on and so forth. From that position, if we were to go due east, we would come in on the target, and that would be 37 miles. And again, using 180 miles an hour, 37, if we call that 35, well, no, it's 37. So at 180 miles an hour, in 1 hour, we would do 180 miles. So in half an hour, we would do 90 miles. So in 10 minutes, we would do 30 miles. We need to do 37. So 30 miles would bring us into about there, by which time we would be within visual range of the target, and we would switch over to the bombardier's position, or already have, and we would fly in on bombardier instructions. So leg one would take us down for 20 minutes, due south on the compass, and leg two would take us due east for 10 minutes. That would get us 30 miles out, and then we would switch over to visuals to bring it in onto the target and finish the job, and hopefully have more success with the bomb run than I had on this one. It takes a little bit of practice. In principle, it is relatively straightforward. The difficulty comes in with pilot-induced error on your tracking, and it's a bit difficult in this plane, and it takes a little bit of practice to minimize those errors. If we're looking at the wet compass down here, course plotting using the lumber line and paralleling the north-south pointer to it in the appropriate direction is a bit of a practice thing rather than a principle thing. In principle, it's straightforward. In practice, it's a little bit challenging to get that parallel correct. You'll end up having course errors that are induced. The directional gyro itself is something that you could use. If you set it up in advance, then you can fly 180 on that. But you'll manually fly it, so you need to be fairly disciplined and fairly, you know, attentive during each leg in order to minimize the pilot error in your navigation. If you're using the course autopilot like I am right now, even though we are flying in the reciprocal of 149 degrees, it's 150 plus 180, which is 330 degrees is our course right now, we still need to set the directional gyro to zero because the autopilot only tracks on zero. So that's a bit of a, we're kind of frigging the system a little bit there in order to be able to use the autopilot. There are advantages to the autopilot because it does help you minimize that course correction. But as you can see, even on our wet compass now, my north-south pointer is not necessarily very parallel at all. And over the long distance, those few degrees of error will translate to quite a distance on the ground being north or south or east or west of the intended target or aim point. So, yeah, doing a dogleg or doing a roundabout navigation to target is going to be very useful when there are squadrons of enemy fighters in the air looking out for bombers coming in to take down and prevent them from attacking their target. They don't seem to have too much of a concern with me because I don't seem to be able to hit anything anyway. But they'd still like to shoot me down, I'm sure. You can make your navigation as complicated as you like or as simple as a straightforward direct to. It depends on the situation. you are going to have to make the judgment that you feel is the appropriate one for the given situation you're in. If you do have fighter escorts with you, which in some cases you will, but not always, that may change the amount of risk that you will be able to take. But, like I say, each situation merits its own evaluation. Our course here has, I believe, taken us a little bit more to the west. Or is it the east? Let me work this out now. If the pointer is there, yes, a little bit more to the east. So I'm expecting once we come out of the clouds that Wilmington is, yeah, I can see it now. Wilmington is going to be over at our 10 o'clock at the moment. So we are going to need to course correct, and once I get a little closer, I'm probably just going to hand fly it in. Eastbourne is there, just kind of in the right half of the square window that I'm looking through. So because of the error in my paralleling up the north-south pointer with the lumber lines, I've actually flown a little bit east of my intended aim point, which is that headland over there with the white cliffs. So what I'm going to do is, from here, I'm going to turn off our autopilot, grab the plane before she falls out of the sky, and basically bring it over, hand fly it back in from here. Altitude is 3,500 feet, dropping slightly, and that's okay, although we don't really want to drop too much out here yet. We are staying relatively low, using the low kind of close to the water tactic, I suppose you might call it, to avoid attention. Hopefully if anybody does see me that's up there really high, they're not going to bother coming all the way down, given that I'm so close. As we're flying on our own and it's quiet, it's all easy and it's no big drama. In a more busy environment, this is actually quite an exciting part of the flight, because you really want to make it back, particularly if you've had a bit more success with your bombing run than I have had. You want to make it back and make it a successful sortie. But that doesn't happen until you're basically there. So just looking at my rudder. My rudder seems to be all over the place at the moment. I'm wondering if I took some damage. The Storm of War stats will tell me quite a lot of information once I get down, after the computer has caught up with itself. And I'll be able to go and see what happened. Did I actually get my bombs registered inside the target area, even though I didn't actually destroy the said target? And it'll also tell me if I suffered any damage from the flak guns when I went over it that second time, low and fast, which may have been a bit pointless anyway, because I think I had no bombs already. They did drop before and miss. Anyway, here we come into Eastbourne. Let me just pull this up really quickly. Wilmington is where we're going. Eastbourne is where we're coming in, and we're going to pick up this water system here just on the west of the headland to track in onto Wilmington field itself. This is Eastbourne that we're about to fly over now, and we're kind of just going to fly parallel with the western part of the coastline there, and we can already see the water that we're going to turn right over and follow it in to the field. We're going to descend ever so slightly, and we're going to bring back our throttles as well, because we don't really need to be accelerating here. We're doing quite enough speed that we can possibly glide into the airfield from here. I can just about see the airfield in the little triangle window to the right of the site. We are actually, yeah, we're going to carry on, but we're going to make an anti-clockwise orbit through the north of the airfield and come back in and land in the same direction as we took off, because we want to land into the wind. I'm going to bring the prop up to full fine, and we're going to keep control of our throttles here. Probably level out at about 1500. Actually, we've gone down past 1500. We don't really want to drop much below 1000 feet for now. So we will bring the plane back under control here for the time being. This is the waterway that we are going to turn right onto. It goes out to the sea. The other end leads up to the airfield. And we're going to turn right over it, actually, and pass out to the west of it and continue a gentle anti-clockwise orbit of the field until we get to the kind of the north side of it, and then we will line up for a landing, and hopefully everything will go well there. 1,000 feet is adequate. We would probably start talking to the field tower now and tell them that we are south of the airfield and turning upwind. Intention full stop landing, Wilmington. Because there isn't a designated runway here, there's no track, it's an open field, we're basically going to work out which way the wind is coming from, and we're going to assume that the wind hasn't changed since we took off some 30 minutes ago, 40 minutes ago, whatever it's been. So Wilmington, downwind, Blenheim, and I would give my call sign as well, so 92 Squadron Joker is downwind Wilmington, and that's all I would say for now. Now, we're going to wait until the field is well out of sight, and we're going to assume behind us. Can't really see back there very much, so I'm just going to use that forestry over here, and I'm going to wait until I'm getting over that forestry. I'm going to apply a little bit of power here because I've dropped down to about 650 feet, which is enough. I don't really need to go much lower yet. I have another turn to perform, and that forestry that's just above Wilmington is what we're going to use, and there's an edge there, the western side of the forestry, that we can use as a rough guide, although we are going to be kind of over the middle of it now, but that's okay. Climbing back up a little bit. Going to make a fairly sharp right turn here now, and might use a little bit of rudder here to bring her around a little bit more authoritatively, and the field should present itself, and there it is. And from now we are Wilmington long finals. I would have called that I was turning base there as well if I was doing this properly. But we are long final. Our speed is 180, and I'm going to drop the throttle quite a bit. And we're going to drop some flaps. And we're going to drop our landing gear. And that's going to knock our speed off quite nicely. Down to about 120, shaking a little bit, because might have dropped that flap and landing gear a little too early. If we can kind of bring it in around about 100 miles an hour, that would be ideal. Keep it over the trees. We don't want to clip those on the way in. Some of these trees are not like some of the other trees. If we hit them, they will upset our apple cart. And there we go. We're not quite landing in the same direction that we took off, but there we are. And we're going to bring our flaps up, try and miss those markers, Jack, and try and miss anything else that's on the field as well. And bringing our stick back to keep our tail down, we're going to apply our brake nice and progressively on and off until we notice that we are slowing down. Now, we were set up when we joined the server and arrived at the field over here by these trees, so we're going to head back there and bring it to a stop well out of the way. Try and taxi your aircraft off the field, or off the main landing area of the field. It's kind of courteous to the other pilots who are coming in, particularly if they're coming in wounded, damaged, bad engines or no engines, dead stick. They're going to need to have a very open and uncluttered field with which to choose their landing site on. So bad news is that I've just gone into soft ground here, which is going to cause a bit of a problem for me. And I've already damaged an air screw. This one here is bent because I've gone into some mud at the end of the field. Ha! Well, there you go. Ain't that just excellent? We have one engine that's not damaged, so we will turn that off now. Bring it to a stop. We'll turn off the fuel on the other one, even though the engine is now damaged. So the guys back in the barn are going to be delighted with me. We will turn off the fuel and yeah, that is a successful sortie insofar as I flew. I got over target. I think I dropped bombs. I did miss them, and I made it back, and everything was going well until I rolled into the mud. I could have stopped short of it, and I didn't. I thought I was safe to get a little closer here, but surprise, surprise, be careful of this area on the field. It's very wet, and I've made a right mess of that, haven't I? Okay, well, that was it. Until the next time, go handy.
So, looking at the detailed stats of this particular sortie, we entered the cockpit at 35 minutes past the hour, took off from the aerodrome Wilmington at 42 minutes past the hour, took a little bit with 20 minutes to fly to the target, and at 6 and 7 minutes past the hour we were damaged by flak, landing back at Wilmington at 32 minutes past the hour. So the sortie was a little less than 1 hour, but unfortunately missing is any evidence of bomb drops. Go handy, catch you next time.